Good afternoon, everyone. I am Shushri Doble, and I will be moderating today's session. Here we are with another session for you. Let us make it more interactive and use this opportunity to its fullest. Hi, sir. It's a pleasure connecting with you virtually.
Same, yeah. Thanks.
Before we start with the session, I would like to give a small introduction about our speaker. Kedar Nimkar is the founder of AudioGyan. He is currently heading the design team at Jupiter Neobank. Before that, he was the head of design at BookMyShow and previously the head of design at ClearTrip. He has been obsessed with design ever since he started working for WebChutney. From advertising, he moved to product-based companies like Bird and Paperplane. After spending more than 16 years in the online world, he realized the lack of documentation in the field of design in India, and that's how he started AudioGyan. He is a design leader who focuses on mentoring and building design teams, partnering with businesses and delivering compelling user experience for brands and products that he works for. We are glad to have you, sir. Over to you.
Oh, wow. That was quite an introduction. It feels different when I read or when I write about it. But yeah, it's quite... So yeah, thank you. Thank you for calling me. The 135 participants. It's kind of a bit overwhelming for me to address such a big crowd. I've never done before, as in like on like a Zoom thing. So Rohit, will there be like, I think two or three friends of mine were planning to join. Is this a open link, or you'll get a admit link and you'll admit them?
They'll get an admit. We will admit them. It's already been informed to the moderators, and I think if there are any, all individuals who were in the waiting room have already been admitted.
Cool. So yeah. So this. I think I'll keep it very informal. There's no like a speaker kind of one-way dialogue. I'll start off with. I've made like a rough presentation, and I'm just setting some expectation for everyone that just a second. Yeah. So I'm just setting expectation that typically what happens is somebody from industry or somebody who is kind of into the system tries to communicate with a lot of jargons and what is happening in the industry and give you like a real picture of, or I would say like a bird's eye view of what's happening in the industry. And typically the sessions are also conducted in that way. What I'm going to do is slightly more hands-on, as in it will be more direct impact kind of a thing. I'll try and do that. It will be more actionable. And since you all are students, I believe I'll ask few questions just to understand what sort of crowd I'm addressing to. And the topic will be mainly around how to make portfolios or how to get hired mainly, right? Because that's the biggest challenge when you are at a graduate or an undergraduate or a postgraduate level. So that's going to be the thing. And don't expect anything fancy. It will be as simple as ki yaar spelling mistake mat karo, right? That is very important when you are climbing the ladder. I'll give you some glimpse. In fact, I'll show you the agenda. 1 second. Okay. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay. So it's the, like, you can see how to make better portfolios, right? Okay. So what I'm going to do is before I start, I would like to just ask a couple of people to give me like a background about like what sort of what sort of profile the crowd has, right? Are they all UI UX designers? Are they general designers? Are they graphic designers? Are they illustrators? For me, because my talk is more towards digital design as such, but if I get a sense, maybe I can cover a bit more of breadth.
Can I answer that for you, Kedar?
Yeah, please.
Super. So Kedar, our audience currently comprises of the master's students in design, first and second year, are a few of them from our final year, large chunk of them from our third year and second year design students. In terms of the specialization, we've got user experience students, product design students, and communication or graphic design students. In terms of how large a set of audience is, is divided among all these three areas, I think communication design or graphic design would be large. Second should be product design, and third should be user experience, or in certain cases, for example, in our third and second year, user experience is also a high number. So we could say that after graphic design, I think the large set of number out of these about 150 odd people would comprise of user experience students.
Okay. So I'll be, and then like the graphic side of things, I started off my career doing that, but slowly I've graduated to like a product design. So graphic design, I am not in touch with the real scene happening, but once you like Massimo Vangeli, the famous designer, has said, like, if you can design one thing, you can design everything, right? So hopefully after 15, 20 years of designing, you understand the abstract of it and you can get into multiple things. But for graphic design, I've just covered one or two bits. Let's see how much useful it is. But it's mainly towards UI, UX, product. Communication design is also part of product design. So yeah. So what I'm going to do is I'll this is the agenda, and please keep noting down any names which I drop names sometimes. You can take those names and Google them so that you can dig more about it. So Guy Kawasaki is one of a Apple evangelist, and he has been an angel investor. So he follows this 10 slide format. So that you know that if it's third slide and you're bored, there's just 7 to go. And if you're on 8th slide and you're excited, you'll be saying that, hey, I want more. So yeah, 10 slide format typically. I'll start with my introduction, quick introduction, and then following with what the recruiters are looking for, what's your design career ladder looking like if you are in a specific field, which is product design. Best framework to make your portfolios, and you can where you can start at this stage and hopefully get hired. And the ninth point will be very much important, because I've been screening and looking at resumes for past 6-8 years now, and it's a pain, right, to look at bad resumes. So hopefully you become sensitive to being designer. You I'm guessing you all are having high empathy levels. So potential recruiter, potential employer, you can be more empathetic towards them and then make or not make certain mistakes in your portfolio. Cool. Thank you for inviting me. My name is Kedar Nimkar, and for those who have joined just now, and I design interfaces. I design digital products. I design experiences for digital products. I also started this small podcast, which is called Audio Gyan. It's mainly documenting designers in the Indian ecosystem, not just designers, but performing artists and everyone, because it's recently I read about a term called as T designer. That is the longer arm of T. You basically specialize in one thing, but the upper arm, the horizontal arm also is very important, where you have more lateral thinking. You understand how puppetry works, or how cities are designed, or how Kathak is as important as pixel perfection, right? So just covering the breadth, and it just helps you to when you are especially working in a B2C environment, because you are the users, and when you are sensitive to different domains, you get to understand their pain points. So yeah, the AudioGAN project has been going well so far. It's about 200 episodes, and it releases every Wednesday. I've just joined a startup, so it's been 2 months that I haven't released any episode, but yeah, it's going to good. Cool. So we'll start off with what do recruiters look in a portfolio? And to begin with, probably in the end of this conversation, I'll have Q&A, but post that I'll send a mail to Rohit, which can be circulated to everyone. I have an EPUB book, which is like one of the classic books which you can read and in fact solve it thoroughly. I'll show you the first page of it. This is how typically any design hiring happens, right? The yellows are the steps. So you get a phone screening call, the person talks to you, understands what your profile is, how smart are you in communication, or how sharp are you in understanding what the potential employer is looking forward to. Typically, on-site or a phone interview is, so this happens in different various levels. For a startup, you might skip certain things. For like a good company like Google, Amazon, or Facebook, they will have these typical phone, which is the recruiter or the hiring manager or probably the HR, the first round. The second one is just to meet the team and understand what you are, like just get a flavor of the team, right? And then portfolio review, which is quite thorough. So you have to be ready with all the reasons why you made certain things in your either in your portfolio, either in a case study and stuff like that. Product design critic, I'm not sure, like as per my exposure, it happens in the same round itself. You generally pick up any good product, which is mutually. So for example, WhatsApp or Instagram or any of the heavily used Google Maps kind of a thing, and you critique it. Right. And there's no right or wrong there. It's just your understanding and your observation. So are you pointing towards the icon consistency, or are you pointing towards the how to search, or how the algorithm worked, or what is the pain point? Different, right? It just helps people to understand what your inclination is towards, what you look when you look at a product. Based on that, if the confidence level is different, you also go through a design exercise. So be prepared for that. At your level, I think it will be very, very obvious to make those design exercises. And then there is like whatever informal round and offer, right? Any questions so far on this? Anybody? So I'll pause for like 5 seconds and then I'll move on.
One of my observations, Kedar, is that in a lot of cases, portfolio review is the first one as well. Instead of the phone screening and on-site. If that is the approach, does that also change the process?
Yeah, actually, now, so this is, the book will be self-explanatory. The book has a lot of Western influence to it. In India, especially in the startup ecosystem, you may not follow this as a rule book, but it just happens very organically, very dynamically. Now, for example, in my company, when I'm hiring, I probably just say no at a resume level itself because I've screened so many resumes, right? And the way... So is it just the resume? Is it a dribble link? Is it a Behance link, or is it a Medium link? That also changes, because when you're sharing dribble links, it's typically good looking shots and good looking graphics, which could be good for a graphic designer or a visual designer. But for a product designer, I expect like a very short write up of what was the thought process, what were the problems. So I'll come to that, how to write a resume or how to write a case study, or how to, 1 second, just a second. Yeah. Yeah, so we'll come to that. But and again, the COVID has changed a lot of things. So in fact, like I've joined Jupyter completely remote. My laptop came home. In fact, I met the team and the founder and everyone, I think after 6 months. So it's going to be a bumpy ride for all the people who want to get recruited, because you like finally your work will work like speak for itself. So it's going to be a different one. Anyway, so moving on.
Hi Kedar. Good afternoon. I'm Swarali Hindekar. I'm a final year design student. I had a question with regards to the design test that companies tell you to do. So when you kind of approach that, do you approach it with the intention of giving the best outcome, or do you focus on the process? So does the company look for what process you're following and what your thought process is? Or do they focus on what kind of outcome you've given for a UI UX driven solution?
Yeah, it's a good question. I would personally, I would look for the process because outcome when you get into the company, you will come to know a bunch of things, right? Which is what is the engineering challenge? What is the data challenge? What is the economics of it? What is the legacy code that you're working on? So a bunch of constraints which you're not aware of. So your outcome may change radically different because you are not aware of the constraints once you're inside the system. So typically what will people look is that your thought process, your approach, how well you have understood the problem statement, and how good have you done your competitive analysis, or what are the industry benchmarks that you have thought through. So it's more about the approach, the process of how you arrived at a solution rather than the outcome.
Right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So these are like a very high level things. So obviously the quality of output, right? Not the output itself, but the quality, how much attention to detail you have provided, what sort of thinking you have put in, how well you have understood the problem statement, how aware are you about the constraints in the domain itself, in the industry itself, and within that company. Bunch of things. But at your level, which is I'll cover in the career ladder part of it, it typically is only the last four, right? This is what a junior or a junior or a beginner level designer, we really look forward to, which is no matter if it's one screen, skip button ka hit area kya hai se leke, are there any typos, what sort of, when it comes to graphic design, if it's going to be print, what is the vector level, how much things you have used as vector and what is pasted, sharpness. To give you one small example, when the poster for this talk has been given, if you see the arms near my left arm, there's a white space, and then the Photoshop was not done correctly. So that's the don't feel bad about it, because it is quite obvious that you're learning. So unless somebody points out, you won't push it to the next level next time. So yeah, these sort of details, right? These sort of details matter a lot. Visual quality, the biggest one which is missing in today's, I don't want to sound uncle, but yeah, missing is hustling and because reading 1,000 Medium posts and writing some good articles or probably doing a podcast doesn't mean that you become complacent, right? You just keep hard working and you hustle around, which is very required for a startup, right? It's not that you've been given a task, you finish, and then, yeah, that's it. That's done, right? You have to follow it through, work with the engineers, work with the analytics team, and get data and keep improving it. And generally, how open are you for feedback? So you may or may not find like a person who give you like a very, very good critical feedback, because everyone is learning. There are certain 3 to 5 years of experience of designers also leading a team. So the maturity levels of designers are also skewed differently. So at times you may not get, at times you may just get a very dismissive feedback ki, was this not working, right? Now, how do you hustle around? So mainly broadly 4 points is what you prepare for. Now, this question is typically asked by everyone, like few good portfolio websites, which we can refer to and what we can generally consume. So I have a list. You can write these the names. You have Best Folios, Behance, Dribbble, Adobe Portfolio Awards, and Medium. But I wouldn't. So that's good for inspiration. And I'll come to that bit later. But I wouldn't recommend getting inspired. I would rather recommend at your level, not for the masters, but for definitely for the undergrad level, that you simply copy it. Right? Copy it as it is, right? If you are able to draw Mona Lisa the way it is, I'm sure you are a good artist. Right? Now, it's just finding the voice and practicing and then making some different artwork. So yeah, just copying it correctly. So the next best option is, okay, just tell me which are the good portfolios that I can review and make one for me. And now I have a list for that also, but frankly, it's just endless. In the World Wide Web, it's crazy, right? You really don't know where to start, what to make, whom to follow. And these are like tops. Anthony Burrell, for those who know graphic design, those who are from graphic design, might be knowing him. Great printmaker, great. I love his work. And yeah, these are like really inspirational, high Twitter followers and Instagram followers, influencer designers. But I wouldn't go with that also. So the tip is basically hunt for a good UI UX product. Look at who is leading the team, who's designing, who are the influential people or who are the designers in that team. Start Googling them, see their personal websites, how they have showcased themselves, and then just follow them, right? You can just keep at it, keep looking at their work. And if possible, because it's so democratic now with Instagram, you can just DM saying that, hey, I want to, just a second. Yeah, I'm so sorry for the thing. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, you can follow your favorite designer and just ask for an internship or whatever, like if they have an opening kind of a thing. So that's with like how to find and whom to follow, right? Now the next thing is any questions so far? Have you followed me a bit of it?
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, hi. This is Pradyumna Bapat. I'm a master's student. So previously you mentioned about, on the slide of few good portfolio designs, you mentioned that the beta students should go ahead and copy what is exactly over there. Yeah. And you said not for the MD student. So what does an MD student look out for in those kind of places?
So I would say, I think it just purely because of the maturity of, or the sheer number of years of experience you have in the domain, right? Now, a lot of people go for masters after doing 2 or 3 years of internship or 2 or 3 years of work also in some companies, right? Because they want to just push the envelope of understanding. So there is this HFI course and different courses. So I think the assumption is that for masters, you are much more in sync with what is happening in the industry. Okay. You must have spent some time with a few design people in the industry. And that was the assumption. But yeah, if it's a fresh start, it's just back-to-back studies, then you can pretty much be there. But broadly, wahi hai ki it, at a master's level, you are expected to know a bit of business, bit of all the things. The upper arm is supposed to be quite enriched. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
So your design career ladder, I will show you a couple of websites and screens if possible. Actually, we are half an hour. So I think, we'll skip it. I'll quickly show you two slides only. So this is Julie Zhuo, who was the head of design at Facebook. She started as an intern and then she became like the VP of design. So she has written multiple books, I think 2 or 3 books as well on design and stuff. So this is how even we try and have like a segregation of how the designers work, right? And for me, this is very important because for the first 5, maybe 10 years, I was mastering the craft and execution part of it. Product thinking naturally came because I was with those sort of people. But when I approached my mentors saying that, hey, like, can I become a lead? And that's when he showed me this sort of a career ladder. I'll walk you through this. And he said that, do you see that you're fitting into it? And I clearly found that it was not. And that's where it was a realization that, yes, I have to improve my skills also to have like a ladder or have like a path to grow as a designer. So to explain this particular slide, I would say that first 5 years, maybe 6 years, I would pay at most an acute attention to craft and execution. You got to learn all the tools. You got to learn what is typography, color theory, alignment, pixel perfectness, a bit of code if possible, basic HTML, CSS, JavaScript, just to know what is possible and what is not, right? Ideally, if you can open up a notepad and write a HTML page, it's great because that's where you understand a lot of things. What is SEO friendly meta tags that you need to write? Bunch of things, right? If you're working on web, what is important? What are schemas? What are the tags which Google crawl naturally and not? From the length to breadth to everything, from top to bottom, all about craft and execution, animation, interactions, mastery over iOS and Android guidelines, how native patterns work, how native patterns work in different web and other places. So how is a particular design component going to be rendered on Safari versus Internet Explorer? I don't know what is running right now, 11, 12, 13, to Chrome, to these native browsers, which Xiaomi and Redmi have, right? Everything. So that's what I talk about, craft and execution. I think once you have like a good grip on it, tools keep changing, but you get to understand at least working with layers and now more collaborative tools like Figma and Sketch and Comet. And I don't know, like it's endless, but at least you should be able good enough to adapt to those, what the company is using. The second is more product design thinking. It is very much required because, and in case of graphic design, I would put it, say, art direction, if I have to draw a parallel, that you look at the bigger narrative, you look at the bigger output, what the company is trying to do, what is the business trying to do, what is the service trying to do, and spend some time thinking about it. Probably be a big contributor after 6 years becoming a designer, be a big contributor in a big company has or features in case of service, but at least for product. So craft and execution, you shadow, you mainly shadow and improve your craft. Product thinking is you take ownership. you have sort of organization level awareness. You are working with product managers and other people to understand how or what the next step should be. And then again, in that also, there are A-B tests and other tactical stuff which you have to learn. And after, I think, 10 to 15 years, you sort of start influencing at multiple levels, right? You work with the founders, you work with the product heads, you work with technology heads. In our case, probably we have to work with banks. How do you influence? How do you bring industry level changes? And then it's just keeps on and on, right? So influencing probably the highest could be Tesla today. Elon Musk is challenging everything and he's influencer. He's changing the market dynamics also. But if you want to come to a more reachable level, that's trying to disrupt how food tech is working. Ola, who's trying to work, Uber and Ola's who are trying to work at a more this transport level or whatever it is. So that's kind of the map you can clearly see. And then if you want to go in details, there are multiple. So at a product level, you have L5, companies have nomenclature. I'll share you two links after this. One is for the EPUB book, which is how to go about building portfolios. And the second one is a link, which has a bunch of other companies, how GitHub is set this. This, I think, an academy. This is what they expect. It's quite overwhelming. You can read it around here. Any questions so far? Because we'll move to like a framework of making a portfolio. Okay. So portfolios framework is something which is very critical, because if you're going to approach Google, if you're Airbnb, booking.com, of those company and not a very early startup, it will help you to put out what process person whom you're to, right? It is just work, because that knows that framework. And even if the person knows, you'll be able to bring your thought process. The framework is called STAR framework. It's very simple. It's a situation. There's a task that you performed or did. Then a bunch of action you did. And then this was the result. Very, very simple framework. I'll give you one example. And then maybe if somebody has any example to share, it could be anything, right? It could be how you solved the leakage issue in your building. This is a problem statement, right? And you are a designer. You have a situation that the terrace was leaking. You did an audit of what was wrong. You got the plumber, and the result was it stopped, right? Very, very simple, straightforward. So I'll give you a more little complex thing. In Book My Show, out of 100 people film, only 20 were given read show. And the good, the more the rating, the good, healthy, like if you see like 4-star rating with 5 reviews, it's not as compelling as opposed to 4-star ratings with 1,000 reviews. So we wanted people to rate plus write a review. So the task given was that obviously increase the percentage of users reviewing. Now, what we did was we did some user research. We looked at analytics, when are we sending the push notification for people to review, what all other touch points are there if the person or the user dismisses it. And then based on all that, we started designing, we started brainstorming what can be done. We figured out that hashtags is quite common. So maybe we can put hashtags instead of person writing in like a long textual format. The rating is a bit fun. So there were sliders. We added a few more nudges when to push that. Because if you send it immediately as the movie ends, because we know movie end timing, they are probably figuring out what to eat. So they'll just dismiss and then go to Swiggy or Zomato and look for the like the cheapest place around, whatever the fanciest place around, and go there. So bunch of things, right? You identify those, and yeah, then we shipped a new variation, a new version of how a user can review more. And yeah, so we got a result that obviously numbers meant a lot for the organization. And as a designer, it also feels nice if there is social validation, someone tweeting about it, someone saying, hey, the new slider is quite cool. So that social validation for a designer is obviously always good, but it should also accompany. In fact, social validation can come later, but the main thing is now instead of 20, 35 people started rating it. So we clearly showed an improvement. Right? Now, if I'm a recruiter or if I am the hiring manager, if this you laid it out in good graphics, in good your iterations of design, and you show an impact, right? Maybe like one or two tweets ka screenshot or purely like a Google Analytics dashboard saying that, hey, you see the spike there? Yeah, I can see it. And obviously people understand where you're bluffing and not. So yeah, I mean, that's the star framework. Any questions here to anybody wants to share anything which they have not explicitly used this, but it was very natural to highlight your particular case study in this format. 146 people, I'm sure at least 5%. Okay, never mind. But great. So in fact, if there is nothing which is from your reaction, so.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
I'll introduce myself first. I'm Anagha. I am a third year student, and I'm majoring in user experience design. Okay. So my question was, how did you like finding out that out of 100 people watching the film, only 20 were giving a rating or a review on Book My Show? So wouldn't be that part of research because you found out about it through analytics?
Sure. No, so typically what happens is there are a lot of product managers in companies who own certain verticals. So there will be a product manager who is responsible for improving, say, like the funnel. So funnel is basically a person lands on Book My Show app and he buys a ticket. So that entire steps is called a funnel, right? So in fact, there are product managers who work on specific funnels, right? So there will be a person who's dedicated to on the seat selection screen, right? How many people drop off or how many people just leave that there, right? Now, based on that, he sees, okay, like 100 people landed, but maybe 15 booked a seat, rest all them dropped. So there are two ways to analyze. You play around with the graphics and show filled, unfilled. You show star rating for seats also. You show reviews, bunch of things. And still, if you see drop off, then you can go into a qualitative user research to understand. And mostly you figure out from your own behavior also. If the theater is empty, why should I pay like a 45 rupee fee just to see it's empty? So there are different things we keep at a very constant level in the company. So in this case, there was a product manager who was responsible for ratings and reviews because that was feeding into something else. So either he or she comes with this data from analytics and data science team, or if you are curious to know why is this, and there are different geographies. So now this 10 is an example of 20 only in, say, Mumbai or North India. But South India, it could be very high because they're very fanatics. They're film buffs. So you like probably you get 100 out of 80 people reviewing a Rajinikanth movie or a Kamal Hassan movie. And so it's quite different. And it's mainly the product manager's job to come up with these insights and these problem statements. And sometimes that's where I said, na, in the career ladder, if you are probably mid to senior level or senior to lead kind of a thing, then you yourself investigate. You yourself get access to all the analytic dashboards and bunch of things, and it becomes part and part of your job, or it also becomes like a responsibility area for you. Because every morning I just look at the dashboard, I see there are there any different patterns, and then just jam with product managers to improve it. Again, it all depends on the scale of the organization you work with, what is the design, how empowered the design team is. So bahut factors hai. So yeah. Any other?
Yes, hi. This is Swarali again. So I had a question with it. I actually love the framework because it kind of very easily conveys, you know, what exactly you've done through the project. So just I wanted to relate it to one of my projects. So there was a project that I did where I worked with an NGO to help them put up a stall in Accenture, and they wanted, so the aim of my role was that I had to create graphics for their stall that would entice enough people so that they could actually permanently, you know, make it stand there. So the result was not really, so in this case, my result was not really in, you know, numeric values. Like it was mostly that it would or it would not get put up, right? Sure. So in that case, when I If I tend to use this format, I would kind of end up by the end of, say, 6 months, it was actually, put up. So is that a valid result in terms of a recruiter?
Yeah, I mean, good that you brought this point, because I slipped one complete different aspect for the graphic design team here, that as in the graphic designers in the call, is that this is now mainly for like product designer, where there are tangible numbers or metrics to follow and to achieve, right? It has been a classic case that I made a nice hoarding, which is on Agra Delhi highway. You really don't know the return on investment, because how many eyeballs did the hoarding caught, and then it was saying that aage ek, whatever, like 200 meters ahead, there is a construction site. Now, how many people go and buy the house is not really matching to that hoarding, right? So it's going to be a tricky one. It's going to be a tricky one for graphic design. But the parallel which I can draw is that when it comes to graphic design, I think in the career ladder, the first part remains as it is. The second is art, right? So you just not only design for that particular brief, but also think of other areas that you move the campaign around. And then you can probably also look into where it was placed. Did you do a small A/B testing of whether it was placed ahead of the desk or as a big banner in the backdrop? Or things. I may not be able to give a very, and then moving forward, then like bigger brand narrative, right? So what does the brand stand for? And then where should we put, should we even produce handbills, because the brand is very exclusive. Do we want to just put a QR code and have everything done by like a product designer, have a marketing page, have a landing page for it, bunch of other things. So it changes now. And plus, that's where you also try and push the envelope. Ki, yaar, I'm doing so much. I want an output, right? Which is measurable.
Yeah.
Now, probably, I don't know, the QR code, how many times the QR code got scanned because that particular website got invoked or was opened due to that QR code. You might have more nuances there. I'm not sure about it.
Works. Just a follow-up question to the same to the same same format. So in terms of the result, a lot of time students and as a design student graduating, we may not have real projects which we have encountered outcome for. So in that case, the simple answer is that we actually go out there and user test it. But like a lot of times there's lots of stuff that's very inspirational in the sense, even as far as UI UX is concerned. So how do you tackle that part of, the result aspect?
As in, if there is no tangible output?
Yes.
Are you saying like your test probably, your test or your task was not really measurable? But
we don't really do real projects, right? We're usually, as a student, our portfolio comprises more of imaginary solutions that they are real problems, but they're not really solutions we've done with an industry or, where tangible outcome may be 100% possible to get.
Sorry to interrupt, but yeah, that's where probably people like me and much more people from alumni network should come in and help. I mean, that's like the biggest contribution you can have to or give to Rohit right now is that trying getting more people in the industry who can give you real life examples. I'll show you a couple of them and then you'll be able to understand. In fact, the product solving product design exercises is all about that. So you can continue with small or big tasks in your college as per the guideline, the rule book. But because it's so much online that you can pick up certain problems and have a proactive case study built also. So I'll show you that. So this is the next slide, in fact, how and where do I start to bring some tangible things. So there are these examples which I can give you, like pick a real world. I'm sure hypothetical problems will be given by college, but try and pick a real world problem, right? And a personal problem mainly. It could be I think there's some story, right? So Airbnb was a personal problem. They didn't have place to stay. Uber was a personal problem. There was also a problem. So yeah, you have like lot of personal problems and you just pick one and try and solve. So in this case, I have this problem. I'm not a industrial designer, but someday I would like to do this. In fancy places, it's solved. So when I enter my lift, I have to always switch on or switch off the fan depending on what state it is in. Right now, this is a problem and be obsessed with the problem. Right now, a simple solution which I've been thinking is that ek weight measure, if it is on, if the weight is this much, it will be all right. But that's where I'm stuck now. And now I need to source that weighing scale, work with some embedded or whatever, some engineers to get that thing done. So yeah, I'm actually stagnant with that solution. So work on the problems more, right? Identify the core problem. So these are problems, right? I need to buy iPhone 15, small app, track. Can I build a small web view which can like just do something about it? Or as much as you can and see the problems there itself. Right. This is a great problem, right? Train and bus tickets are ugly. Like they stamp, they plug. I don't know what happens there. Electricity bills, ATM slips, all are ugly. I don't know why. Now, in case if the college is not giving such problems, you can pick one, right? It's finally designer. And then these are fancy, which anybody gives you this is a classic problem which a lot of companies ask you to do. Like, I want a chilled lime juice when I enter my house. Like, home automation karo ya kuch bhi karo ya pata nahi. Like, Apple Watch se kuch connect karo, make a juicer and things connected and whatever, Internet of Things. And so that's what, like, I don't want to get into those fancy words, but just look at the problem and try and solve it. Right? So for this, I think there's a must have book. Which is this? Take a screenshot of this ebook. I'll try and send. I have the Mac version of it. Maybe you can torrent and do whatever, but just get this book or buy. Yeah. So the book has these sort of examples, right? Design an ATM machine for children. Design a restaurant reservation management platform. I don't know, redesign. And redesign is another good problem to solve also. So you're using Spotify. You find a pain point after, say, 6 months of usage, and you say, yeah, I'll solve this, right? And there are a lot of case studies where people have solved it and just got a job there at company, because it's out there, right? You solve it nicely, you get peer reviewed, you get like some good friend to review it, put as a Medium post, and just tweet that person, hey, like, whatever, Swiggy ka head of design is Srinath. You just tag Srinath saying, hey, Srinath, you want to have a look at this. A great way to, like, it's great today. So yeah, I'll send that. Moving on to the last part, we have 7 minutes. I'll wrap this in 2 minutes. So we'll have at least 5 minutes of question answers if there are any. So do's and don'ts in a portfolio, right? So don't just put it help anybody. It will probably graphic designers, yes. It's just screenshots and real life thing. For product designers, no screenshots, right? It doesn't help. I at least write something about it. Why did you do? What was the thought process? Don't share Google links and don't share like Dropbox links. Like nobody has time to open and read, right? Here are 10 options. Like I've done this, right? Although you might be enthusiastic and you have put in a lot of hard work in doing those 10 assignments, I don't have the time. So stop two. Ideally one is great, because that's where a designer is also curator. So you do 10 things, you find 10 solutions, but you pick one, which is actually curation, right? So you can't just plaster with like 10 links and this is what you see. Right now, if the company is desperate, they might look at it, but not recommended. So yeah, in short, have like solid empathy towards, mainly don'ts, because the do's are what I've told you earlier. At your level, I think check spellings. In fact, deck to my friend, he pointed out 2-3 spelling mistakes. So I didn't have much time, but I'm sure a lot of English can be improved in this deck also. Due to short time, so write up as far as possible. And this I've added new, never ever sound miserable. So what has happened is, I understand there are different levels and different stratas of society that we live in. People have lost well-to-do jobs in the pandemic. But yeah, that doesn't, I don't know. I probably don't have enough empathy towards them, but it shouldn't sound miserable, right? I've lost my job and now I need one. I think that shouldn't be in your message. So be very careful about it. I'm not saying that some of you must have put in, but just be very, very cognizant about it. And know whom you're sending to. If the person is R-A-H-O-O-L Rahul, don't write R-A-H-U-L. In fact, we rejected 2 candidates last week just because, we were expecting that them to be communication designers, copy experts, and they're making this sort of a mess. Like, at least reply to all me. You can see the email ID, right? Google them. What position they are in that company. Why are they entertaining you? All these are just empathy, which every designer should have. So know whom you're sending to. The last sentence is this mass mail. Samajh jata hai jab mass mail. Right? Sirf hello Kedar ke jab hello Rohit likh diya, to you understand. At least change one line, right? It's a pain, but yaar, matlab, you have to do that. Do a peer review of email work, case studies, Medium post, blog post, shots, Behance work, anything. Just do a quick peer review. Multiple people. In fact, those are also your your potential hires, maybe you don't know. Right? So you just have them, or they might find something interesting that you can get value added. Try and have a website if possible, quick and dirty. There are a lot of now this Wix and I think obviously WordPress and other places are there, but if you have that, it creates a very different impression. I mean, if it's fancy, definitely it's expected that you got help. But if it's crude, then at least the designer or the potential recruiter is aware ki yaar isne kuch fight mara hai, right? At least kuch, something is put there. Now, it may not be mobile friendly, fine. Right? Or it is mobile first, it's fine. So yeah, this is more hygiene. Do not steal, work and lie. We are living in a very small industry. Everyone is online. Everyone is watching nonstop. If you steal, it's going to be get caught. And then it's a very bad impression for at least 4 years. Right. Again, depends on what's, because we have our own checkboxes also internally. So like, in fact, I could share one quick story. There was a girl who had come, had given her a test. She did phenomenally well in the test. And it was quite like, we were very happy to get her. So the last round we called her for a face-to-face and I did a whiteboard exercise where she was exactly opposite, miserably failed. It was a clear sign, right? And then we did a bit of background research and like someone helped her do that test, was already in our company. You don't get into that part. This is mainly for graphic designers. If you want to, I don't know, illustrate Raja Ravi Verma's painting, go for it, right? But credit it and copy perfectly, especially with graphic designers. There's so much out there on Instagram, right? From David Carson to Paula Scher. People have seen work. So especially those who are hiring. And yeah, one last one is, yeah, I mean, I'm not interested whether you're married, where do you stay, what is your PIN code? Probably an email ID and phone number is good, right? Height, weight, body. Yeah, ye main kyun bata raha hun, pata hai? Like lot of people in this group, 146, how many of there left? Oh, like probably 10 people have left. But yeah, you'll see a lot of people finding this silly, but yaar, ye koi batata nahi hai. So I'm telling you, is my experience. Wow, this sharp 4. So I'm done. But I we'll open up for questions. Probably 5 minutes. Rohit, that's fine. Rohit is not there. But yeah, anybody, anything, anybody has any questions?
Hi, good morning. Good evening, sorry. I'm Archit from MDesk here.
Yeah.
So basically, my question was, as I've seen some portfolios on Behance or somewhat. First portfolio, one of the portfolio I saw, it was containing only 4 projects. Mm-hmm. And they were explained widely. So how the process was going and how he achieved the final outcome. But there was only 4 projects and was lined up. And another portfolio I saw, it was containing 2 projects and of different, means say one was packaging design, I think, and other was a product. And after that, he was containing some renders and sketches. So I mean to ask, see, what should it contain more? One of it containing only 4 projects, but that was the main project, and the other was containing a variety of works. So which one is better according to you, or what is you look for as a recruiter, or how, which will you select?
No, so there are 2 parts to this question, as in like 2 answers to this question. One is, in fact, multiple answers, but I'll just ramble and you get what you can get out of it. Yeah. One is for graphic designers, the more the better, the more versatility you show in your work, the better. And so that's one point. The second is, in fact, for any designer, right, you can put up as much work as possible online, because that's where you get some sort of validation also. And it becomes like a blogging method also. You just keep looking at your work also over the years. So great way to keep blogging, great way to keep putting work online. What I meant was sending work to a potential recruiter is that you curate out of the 1,000 things you have put on Instagram or 1,000 things you have put on Dribbble. So it could be that you have 10 or 15 or 50 projects on Behance, right? But for this company, I want them to look at this. And this is what I can bring to the table in this context. Since I have only one link and I have got just one mail, I'm clear. I should go and dig you further. But what I meant, sending one or two or three, is that because you are clear that aapke company is important. Hai, right? Now, you may have a car, or you may have designed a lime juice mixer, but I'm looking for like a guy who is good with interactions, who click button ke click pe kya kya kar sakte ho, right? Good animations and stuff. You might have done that also. You're interested in both. So just don't send me Behance link, but probably one Behance link where you have done that work. And if I want, I'll Google it. So that's the second part of it. Third is, just try and explain how you arrived at a particular solution or sketches or design. Have some sort of annotation, right? I don't know how to do it for graphic design, but for web or for interaction design or for product design, I may give some tips which I've already. But put context here, right? Otherwise, it's just eye candy, which is good, but I have to ask questions. Yeah, yes, Sabana, all these tips and tricks are just to fast forward the position of you being in a position to getting hired. That's about it. Aisa kuch ye nahi hai ki ye karo, wo mat karo, aisa kuch nahi hai. It is just, this is just probably adding 5% to your entire knowledge of at this point in time. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I got it. According to the company requirements, actually, we have to set our portfolios.
Correct. Company requirements se bhi zyada na, now I think you are in a day and age that there are so many options that you can pursue what you want. And I'm sure there must be some company who's doing the exactly the same thing. So if you find that resonance, great. Nahi to consider in steps to skills and on the job, and then get into the industry and then figure out.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome. Any more questions, anybody?
Yes, sir. I have a question. I'm from BDES last year. And my question is that for making UI UX portfolios, we have to add a lot of text. Like all that text is necessary. We have to add research. We have to add personas. But if it's too text heavy, it would be boring for the recruiters to go through it all. So how can we make it more engaging?
I think let's do this exercise someday. Ki cafe coffee day ka bill hi tum redesign ek bar. So there will be 1,000 things you learned and you would like to share. I don't know. This is a very tricky question because it's not likhne ke liye nahi likh rahe ho na text. Like when you're writing text, you are writing it for a reason. Now, it's not that you just dar lik diya and char images laga diye and done, right? And that's where the STAR framework is there. Now, I showed you like the entire thing in four slides. In one slide, four bullet points and probably five visuals. My job is done. Now, I took effort to articulate that in two lines, three lines. So part of being designer is also that somebody, some product manager or someone will give you like a one page paragraph and say, ki ye laga do. Now you are empathetic. You are the very reason you're saying is that, you know, people don't read. Now you're already aware of the problem, which is a great thing. Right now, how you build on top of it, saying, ki yaar, people won't read. So can I put two lines and have in between visuals? Can I put like a good paragraph, or can I condense the same thought in one line? That becomes your communication design pattern. So if you have 1,000 things to say first, and just tell five things. Now five things bhi char paragraph mein ja rahe hai, to can I support it with visuals? Can I play with typography? Can I pull out one line which I want the person to read? I'll make it big, loud with 48 font size. I don't know. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It does.
So treat, in fact, paragraph, text, long pages, I treat that as design only. It's our job to make it either visually communicating or with typography or with just finding a good pleasing font and writing it with correct line height. इसलिए बोल रहा हूँ बहुत layers हैं design में, ऐसा नहीं कि just कुछ बना दिया.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
All right, I think,
Good afternoon, sir. Nitya here, I'm a final year student. I am pursuing communication design and I want to shift into UI, but I'm confused and still trying to figure out how should I build my portfolio.
Come again, you are working in?
I am pursuing communication design. But I want to shift to UI design. That is something that I feel my interest lies in. But okay. I have a portfolio which is very focused on communication design. I'm still not able to how should I make my portfolio? How should my first step that I can show that I am interested in UI? Because so far I've been trying to work on things I see online and trying to copy them and understand how are they made, but still my portfolio is not that built.
And what are you learning in communication design, as in what are the broad subjects?
It's mostly graphic design, publication design, typography and all that.
Okay. यार ये थोड़ा सा डिटेल बात करना पड़ेगा बिकॉज आई डोंट नो. मे बी यू कैन स्टार्ट विथ सो देयर इज समथिंग कॉल्ड एज माइक्रो कॉपी. हैव यू हर्ड ऑफ इट?
नो सॉरी आई कुडंट हियर यू. माइक्रो व्हाट?
माइक्रो कॉपी. माइक्रो कॉपी.
Yeah.
So a lot of you can go and research how different tone of voices are there for different companies, right? From MailChimp to Airbnb to Uber to Spotify. Everybody has a section called as tone of voice.
Okay.
Right. It is something which sets that brand apart in terms of communication.
Yeah.
Okay, so you can dig there and probably dig something to like how are micro copies written. That could be your way inside UX. Okay, so I think Google a micro copy. What is micro copy? Where is it used? How is it used? In what context do designers use it? Especially with like everywhere, micro copy is used everywhere. It's the small line of text which is written to communicate a particular screen, right? Next step is that you have to enter PAN card. So, yeah. Wo chota line jo likha hai, apart from the main button, is called a micro copy. So I think you can just venture or try some poking around there. And then get into UI UX. I think that could be a nice way if that helps.
Okay, sir. I would do that. Thank you so much.
Cool. So I would conclude. Sorry. Yeah. Go ahead. Anybody?
No, I think I'm sure that there'll be more questions, but in the interest of time and the next session that we have to do, which is the mentoring session, I would request you to give the vote of thanks. But Kedar has been a dear friend. In fact, we are hosting him second time, though both times it wasn't at campus. 2 years ago, he was speaker at Avantika Designeering Series Mumbai event that we had done. And It was a lovely conversation, Dinesh, well, and super inspirational. Absolutely, today's presentation was also very great. And you can read that on comments also, Kedar, that you know, the students are writing for you. Without further ado, for vote of thanks, and then we'll all present the authors can move to the boring session. Yes, Rishi.
Just before that, so thank you for this. Ek sabke liye like ek blanket tip hai. Theek hai, like blanket as in like sabke liye, because you guys are from a town and a city which is close to Kumar Gandharv. He's like one of the person whom I really look up to. So unke ek interview ka ek chota sa kissa batata hun, and probably I'll end with that note. Ki unko, and I think someone asked just now, it's also to answer her, the last person who asked something. Ki somebody asked in one of the interviews to Kumar Gandharv that ye kaun sa gharana hai, राइट, गाते वक्त कौन से घराने का गाना है, ये कैसे आइडेंटिफाई करें. तो डैट ही जस्ट सिंपली सेड कि यार वेरी नाइस, वेरी बहुत अच्छा क्वेश्चन है, इसके लिए काम करो, बहुत सुनो. दैट्स वाज द आंसर, राइट. सो यू जस्ट कीप डे इन डे आउट 365 डेज एंड यू विल स्टार्ट नोटिसिंग द न्यूएंसेस एंड देन anyways the singer will say ki yaar main to Agra gharane se hu, so you'll just connect the dots. That's very simple. So at a early stage career, I think I use a very local Bombay term ki ghiso, right? Jitna ghisoge, jitna pixel push karoge, utna will be helpful, right? And yeah, once you master that craft, then you don't have to worry about alignment, which unfortunately I have to still do, give feedback at this level also to a lot of people. So you just master the pixels first, and if you are in digital design, otherwise hard pe mastery lao if you are in painting. So craft is important at for everyone at your stage, definitely. Cool, thanks for having me.
As we are near to the end of this session, I would like to thank you, sir, for taking out time and sharing this insights with us. Your valuable inputs will surely help us to make better portfolios. We wish you the best of luck in all your future endeavors.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. See you. Bye. Thanks.